act like a serious threat. It's not only important, but still it poses a serious threat to canola production, not only in Western Australia, but across Australia. There is a lot of genetic diversity exists in blackleg as a result of recombination happening at the reproduction stage, which results in evolving races, you know, thousands of races, which can have increased virulence to the current existing races and which have the ability to overcome resistance in our resistant varieties. And secondly, the disease, the fungus itself survives on stubble. So as long as the stubble stays on the ground, there is a lot of inoculum available. The severity is also determined by canola intensity and environment, especially in case of areas where is a canola is grown quite intensively and in high rainfall situation when the conditions are really conducive for these disease. All these factors contribute to the seriousness of this disease. So first of them is assess your risk from blackleg. This is really, really important. So if you want to really manage your disease effectively, first you have to look at what sort of risk you have from blackleg. Reduce residue carryover and crop rotation in order to avoid sowing in close proximity to the previous year's residues. Also choose varieties which are very resistant to blackleg. And not only that, you should be able to rotate these resistance groups. And also apply fungicides where disease pressure is high. With the introduction of varieties with Sylvestris based resistance, and these varieties had actually the resistance in these varieties was based upon single dominant gene or maybe two or three major dominant gene, and which actually put a lot of selection pressure on the blackleg fungus. So as a result, the resistance broke down in Eyre Peninsula in 2003. So, you know, we noticed in 2004 where the resistance to blackleg has broken down in Surpass or varieties with Sylvestris based resistance. Farmers were timely advised, and as a result, they stopped growing varieties with Sylvestris-based resistance, and we just avoided complete wipeout by doing that. The blackleg population in your individual farm may be different, so you really have to consider what cultivars or varieties you are growing on your farm and your neighbors are growing. So then you have to look by monitoring your crop in your paddock to see what level of disease you are getting. So we did quite a lot of work on looking at timing of Pseudothecia maturation in different areas of Western Australia. And this was studied for 3 years at four different locations. And also data was collected from four different paddocks from each location. You can well imagine how much work has gone into this. And also we studied the discharge of ascospores for 3 years from three different locations. Okay, I'm not going to present the data from all these trials that we did. I'm just trying to highlight the results only from one of the trial that we did in 2000. So this data is from East Chapman, where we looked at timing of Pseudothecia maturation and daily ascospore discharge pattern. So as you can see that this is the timing when the fruiting bodies of Pseudothecia were mature in East Chapman, which was around 10th or 11th of July. So once the Pseudothecia were mature, the ascospores started releasing from those fruiting bodies or Pseudothecia, and these are the peaks of ascospore on a daily basis. So what we found from this data, there were two major driving factors for this process: temperature and rainfall. So as soon as the temperature started dropping below 22 degrees, and we have 4 millimeter rain in the past week, so that actually drives the whole process. That's when the Pseudothecia start maturing. So what we need is 43 favorable days. So once we reach that number, so every day can be considered as a favorable day when it has a temperature below 22 degrees centigrade, and the rainfall over the past week was 4 millimeter and above. 4 millimeter is the threshold. It can be above, but not below that. So then we can tell, okay, once the process is completed, now the spores will start discharging from there on in all those areas The blue areas indicate low risk, black areas indicate medium, and the red areas indicate high risk. So you can see, according to the model's predictions, if growers are about to sow their crop around 14th of April, the risk was low, especially in areas like Kahnama, Chapman, Corrigan, and medium risk in all these areas, including Esperance Down, and of course, again, low risk in all those other areas in the northern region. Yeah, so basically what Sporacle has done, predicted the likelihood of maturation of Cirrhothesia in all those locations. So these red dots indicate that the maturing is happening in late April. Black dots indicate the Cirrhothesia will be maturing by early May. And these blue dots indicating the maturation will be happening like and mid-May to end May and so on. Okay, in conclusion, blackleg still remains a major disease constraint in the expansion and production of canola in Western Australia, not only in Western Australia, but across Australia. So therefore, integrated management approaches are crucial for sustainable and canola production and profitable canola production, in fact, and research is still continuing towards further refining management strategies.
When it comes to canola, think twice could refer to a seed treatment or in furrow plus a foliar, or it could refer to cultural practice plus fungicides, depending on how you come at it. This is now, I guess, the current Prezzaro label going into this season. So we've got that 375 to 450. Obviously, we've got different timings for the different diseases. From a fungicide management perspective, gives us all these different impact or jockey into our Prezzaro blackleg windows, and this is where we start to think twice, I guess, in some of the northern areas maybe where Sclerotinia is appearing, when do we deploy our blackleg spray if we have to spray for sclero and those sorts of things. This really highlights why it's about not just one option, and it's thinking twice, jockey on its own, better than untreated in reducing the severity of the stem canker across cobbler, torrific and crusher. We could put Prezzaro on its own at that sort of 4 to 6 leaf stage, and it does a good job, but when you worked out the economics, you're probably better off with just the seed treatment. But where it pays off is this jockey stayer plus Prezzaro in terms of reducing the disease. So. And that sort of looks like this, and what Ravjit was referring to before about plant resistance and things like this, we're seeing that we've actually got a lot of blackleg in the actual base of the stem there, despite the fact that the plant's still standing up. So we're reducing some of that getting in that earlier window at four leaf types timing, whereas some of this has been in there for a while. So. That's the aim of the game, I guess, is to try and clean up this canopy, which is what we're looking to do from the foliar to prevent it getting into the stem, but also to maintain the canopy for as long as we can so we've got as much power going into filling those pods out. If we compare everything to a percentage of having jockey stayer on the seed, so if that's our 100% for yield and we had an average of 2.24 tonne off all of these sites, which were MS varieties, in 2011, we lost yield by doing nothing at all. We came up here and we set about just putting Prezzaro on. We'd already allowed infection to be present in a lot of these sites, so we're sort of chasing our tail. So whilst it's thereabouts on economics, it's not really paying off. Where it is again is where we've, this whole think twice, the jockey stayer plus the Prezzaro is giving us that, 12%. Concluding from this perspective of Prezzaro, I guess with blackleg and canola, that it doesn't take the place of an in-furrow or on-seed treatment for seedlings. It's the combination with. That's where the strength is. We know that the MS and MS to MR is where we get our consistent responses, but MRs can break down if we're growing them consistently. Getting in early with the foliar spray we know works much better for blackleg, particularly in areas that have high spore shower, and there is a bit of a rate response, particularly under higher pressure. And we know that two sprays is more effective, I guess, but at the end of the day, you know, the key is that 4 to 6 leaf timing. And we know that a key thing that also happens is this whole canopy retention that we see from an application of the fungicide.